was not always the case. When first in London, I impulsively jumped into the Thames one evening and swam the 2 miles from Chelsea to Blackfriars, inspiring me to invent swim fins. Speaking of the aquatic, look at the lake. You may see the foolhardy attempt to sail in weather too inhospitable for such an endeavor, and wish to tell those mariners that just because they've paid for their breakfast, swallowed it, and feel sure of it, it will scarce be half an hour before the lake will lay claim to it. You may see people bringing books to the park, or e-readers, as you call them. Did you know I established the first circulation library? And don't you now share your files and music on your devices, all of which use the electricity I began to harness? Incidentally, if you attempt the kite experiment, be certain to use a silk handkerchief, as it is less likely to tear. You may also see things that are not here but need to be. In my time, I saw the need for bifocals, lightning rods, stoves, glass harmonicas, a flexible catheter for your comfort, and, yes, a revolution. I stand here before you, seemingly frozen in the 18th century, but I possess an insatiable curiosity. While I was soliciting funds from France to finance our revolution, I witnessed the first balloon ascension. But what good is it? The skeptic said to me. What good is a newborn baby? I replied. Gentle caller, my mind races with possibilities. May yours do the same. Today is, after all, yesterday's pupil. I beg my leave of you now, for he who speaks much is much mistaken.
establishes that so-called greatness is not so much a matter of ability or strength of character as the opportunities we encounter. I was blessed to save the Union, but due only to a political accident. In 1858, I lost in my efforts to unseat the U.S. Senator Stephen Douglas, a Democrat from Chicago. 2 years later, the Republican National Convention met in the city. Although I had failed against Douglas in our native state, my Chicago friends contrived after three ballots to see me nominated to face Douglas for president, a race I won. So now, by the unaccountable grace of that divine being who guides us all, I loom above you, forever facing this city of Chicago, which occupied so fateful a place in my life. I was a person of mean origins, whose parents could not read, and who as a young man worked at jobs like mill hand and store clerk. But the Lincoln of Chicago was, I acknowledge, a person of prominence. At 25, I had been elected to the Illinois legislature, where I was encouraged to study law. Blessed with native amiability and a gift for oratory, I demonstrated a touch with juries that led me to become one of the state's better-known lawyers, and be I honest, a person of growing wealth, if not modesty. When I came first to Chicago in 1847, I had just been elected to the U.S. Congress. I served only a single term, and afterwards declined to resume my law practice here amid the hubbub of Chicago. Yet I was here for a month virtually every year thereafter, pleading cases in the U.S. District Court, often on behalf of the railroads. During those stays, I was frequently invited to make speeches, especially about the extension of slavery, which I regarded as an abomination. My legal and political activities fused the friendships that propelled my presidential nomination and led me to become leader of this great nation. And in turn, the figure so grandly memorialized here. I bid you an affectionate farewell.
Yeah. Well, here he comes.
At the ground?
Yeah,
he does that when you see dogs, he gets down on all fours and sniffs the ground.
Oh, the ostrich is over there. Okay.
Alpaca.
What is that?
Those are those two, the white and brown one.
What is that?
Mama got these. Okay, let's go on to the next thing, okay?
That's all right,
you're fine. Up and up and you are okay.
You go here or you can walk. Good boy. Good choice. I won't even strap you in, you can go in and out.
He's in a corner over there, the lynx. Yeah, he's sitting in a corner. You're welcome.
I think the sea lions always go.
Right here, right here. Yeah, it's okay though. It's in glass.
We can't go this way because I saw Texas.
Okay. Here, I'll help you.
I saw.
Well, you can't read the
paper. That's the way that they go out.
Why are they birds from Florida?
Mama, what was the stage of Florida? I think that's a dollar.
Oh, that means I can go here. Yeah.
Northern helmeted curassow. Did you see that one, Ryu?
Yeah.
Look at its head, it has like an egg-like hat.
Yeah. And look at that one.
And it's a fully black bird. From Venezuela and Spain. I'll come over to you. What do you want?
So scary. You say hello to the bird.
Thank you.
She wants one.
You got one? I didn't find one.
I can see how old the world.
Yeah, bring my hair over there.
Thank you.
Thank you.